Preface, Cattle Trypanosomiasis, History of Sleeping Sickness. Preface. Everyone must agree with the Secretary of State for the Colonies, who told the House of Commons on June 27, 1912, that undoubtedly the most anxious problem of the present and the future in connection with tropical medicine is that of sleeping sickness. Yet in spite of the voluminous literature which has appeared on the subject during this century, there is no popular history of the disease in the British tongue, though the Germans are indebted for a very good one to that master of science, the late Professor Koch. The director of the Tropical Diseases Bureau, whom I have to thank for many favors, has therefore encouraged me to write these pages, which were, in the first instance, delivered as three lectures at Gresham College in February last, appeared in print in the Medical Press and Circular in April, and are now published by the combined desire of the Research Defense Society and of the Gresham Committee, which has kindly contributed a grant toward their publication. I shall be rewarded if this brief account of other men's labors proves to be of any value to a few of the many English-reading explorers, missionaries, and merchants in Africa who are living within the danger zone, and last but not least, to their many relatives and friends in this country. 31 Cavendish Square, London, October 1912. Sleeping Sickness. Cattle Trypanosomiasis. It is a well-known fact that when Great Britain acquired her first colonies, the bold spirits who embarked on distant adventure were actuated, partly by a fine spirit of enterprise, but greatly also by the desire of gain. And for many years the mother country looked upon her colonies merely as a source of plunder. But as time went on, she learnt some bitter lessons and terrible upheavals, such as the secession of the great American colonies and the Indian Mutiny, caused it to be borne in upon her that possession also meant responsibility. Wherever British influence is now recognized, we have learnt to take upon us the white man's burden. To find out the scourges of the country we profess to protect, and to endeavor to rid it of its enemies. In this, the United States of America, France, and Germany are not behindhand, but in proportion as our colonies are larger than those of other countries, so much greater is the work to be done by Englishmen, and I think we may say that we have not been faithless to our task. Since the days of early travelers in Africa, a scourge of the greatest magnitude to natives and to Europeans has been that of the tsetse fly, Glossina morsitans. Until lately, it was not known why the bite of this insect caused cattle, horses, and many other domestic animals to die of a definite disease, but the fact that this occurred was known to all, and many native remedies were employed, all more or less useless. For instance, that great medical missionary and explorer, David Livingstone, found in his travels that some tribes in Africa believed that lion's fat smeared on the tail of an ox would prevent the bite of the insect, and for this purpose lion's fat was conveyed from districts where the king of beasts was plentiful. Again, he came across a remedy consisting of the bark of a root unknown to him, which was mixed with a dozen dried tsetse flies, ground together into a fine powder, and then administered internally to the animals whenever symptoms appeared. The cattle were also fumigated by burning under them the rest of the plant pertaining to the root. The chief, who told him of this secret and somewhat homeopathic remedy, frankly admitted that it would not cure all the bitten cattle. In Livingstone's writings, we find the tsetse fly and its ravages referred to again and again. Thus, in his Missionary Travels, published in 1857, he writes, "On approaching the confluence of the Tamanakli, we were informed that the fly called tsetse abounded on its banks. This was a barrier we never expected to meet, and as it might have brought our wagons to a complete standstill in a wilderness where no supplies for the children could be obtained, we were reluctantly compelled to recross the Zuga. Then this keen observer goes on to tell us of the fly, and by our modern knowledge we can see how near to the truth both the native traditions and his own deductions arrived. The cattle, in rushing along the water in the Mababe, probably crossed a small patch of trees containing tsetse, an insect which was shortly to become a perfect pest to us. We had come through another tsetse district by night and at once passed our cattle over to the northern bank to preserve them from its ravages. A few remarks on the tsetse or Glossina morsitans may here be appropriate. It is not much larger than the common housefly and is nearly of the same brown color as the common honeybee. The after part of the body has three or four yellow bars across it. The wings project beyond this part considerably, and it is remarkably alert, avoiding most dexterously all attempts to capture it with the hand at common temperatures. In the cool of the morning and evening, it is less agile. Its peculiar buzz, when once heard, can never be forgotten by the traveler whose means of locomotion are domestic animals, for it is well known that the bite of this poisonous insect is certain death to the ox, horse, and dog. In this journey, though we were not aware of any great number having at any time lighted on our cattle, we lost 43 fine oxen by its bite. We watched the animals carefully and believed that not a score of flies were ever upon them. A most remarkable feature in the bite of the tsetse is its perfect harmlessness to men and wild animals, and even calves, so long as they continue to suck the cows. We never experienced the slightest injury from them ourselves personally, though we lived 2 months in their habitat, which was in this case as sharply defined as in many others, for the south bank of the Chobe was infested by them, and the northern bank, where our cattle were placed, only 50 yards distant, contained not a single specimen. This was the more remarkable, as we often saw natives carrying over raw meat to the opposite bank with many tsetse settled upon it. The poison does not seem to be injected by a sting or by ova placed beneath the skin, for when one is allowed to feed freely on the hand, it is seen to insert the middle prong of three portions into which the proboscis divides somewhat deeply into the true skin. It then draws it out a little way, and it assumes a crimson color as the mandibles come into brisk operation. The previously shrunken belly swells out, and if left undisturbed, the fly quietly departs when it is full. A slight itching irritation follows, but not more than in the bite of a mosquito. In the ox, this same bite produces no more immediate effects than in a man. It does not startle him as the gadfly does, but in a few days afterwards the following symptoms supervene. The eyes and nose begin to run, the coat stares as if the animal were cold, a swelling appears under the jaw and sometimes at the navel, and though the animal continues to graze, emaciation commences, accompanied with a peculiar flaccidity of the muscles, and this proceeds unchecked until perhaps months afterwards. Purging comes on, and the animal, no longer able to graze, perishes in a state of extreme exhaustion. Those which are in good condition often perish soon after the bite is inflicted with staggering and blindness, as if the brain were affected by it. Sudden changes of temperature produced by falls of rain seem to hasten the progress of the complaint, but in general the emaciation goes on uninterruptedly for months, and do what we will, the poor animals perish miserably. When opened, the cellular tissue on the surface of the body beneath the skin is seen to be injected with air, as if a quantity of soap bubbles were scattered over it, or a dishonest, awkward butcher had been trying to make it look fat. The fat is of a greenish-yellow color and of an oily consistency. All the muscles are flabby, and the heart often so soft that the fingers may be made to meet through it. The lungs and liver partake of the disease. The stomach and bowels are pale and empty, and the gallbladder is distended with bile. These symptoms seem to indicate what is probably the case, a poison in the blood, the germ of which enters when the proboscis is inserted to draw blood. The poison germ contained in a bulb at the root of the proboscis seems capable, although very minute in quantity, of reproducing itself. For the blood after death by tsetse is very small in quantity and scarcely stains the hands in dissections. Many large tribes on the Zambezi can keep no domestic animals except the goat, in consequence of the scourge existing in their country. Our children were frequently bitten, yet suffered no harm, and we saw around us numbers of zebras, buffaloes, pigs, pallas, and other antelopes feeding quietly in the very habitat of the tsetse, yet as undisturbed by its bite as oxen are when they first receive the fatal poison. There is not so much difference in the natures of the horse and zebra, the buffalo and ox, the sheep and antelope, as to afford any satisfactory explanation of the phenomenon. Is a man not as much a domestic animal as a dog? The curious feature in the case that dogs perish though fed on milk, whereas calves escape so long as they continue sucking, made us imagine that the mischief might be produced by some plant in the locality, and not by the tsetse, but Major Varden of the Madras army settled that point by riding a horse up to a small hill infested by the insect, without allowing him time to graze, and though he only remained long enough to take a view of the country and catch some specimens of tsetse on the animal, in 10 days afterwards the horse was dead. There is no cure yet known for the disease. A careless herdsman, allowing a large number of cattle to wander into a tsetse district, loses all except the calves, and Sebutuane once lost nearly the entire cattle of his tribe, very many thousands, by unwittingly coming under its influence. Inoculation does not ensure immunity, as animals which have been slightly bitten in 1 year may perish by a greater number of bites in the next. But it is probable that with the increase of guns the game will perish, as has happened in the South, and the tsetse, deprived of food, may become extinct simultaneously with the larger animals. In 1895, the Honorable Sir Walter Healy Hutchinson, then governor of Natal and Zululand, persuaded Surgeon Major, now Sir David Bruce, of the Army Medical Service, to investigate and report upon the disease as it occurs in Zululand. Accompanied by his competent wife as his sole laboratory assistant, Major Bruce proceeded to that part of the country where tsetse were abundant and carried out minute and patient investigations. He found that the disease affected almost all the domestic animals, that its duration varied from a few days or weeks to many months, that it is inevitably fatal in the horse, donkey, or dog, but that a few cattle recover. The local name, Nagana, means in the Zulu language to be depressed or low-spirited, but the name varies in different countries, and the disease is often simply known as the fly disease, from the correct assumption that it is caused by the bite of the tsetse fly. By many experiments on animals and by microscopical examinations, Major Bruce proved that the tsetse fly, Glossina morsitans, was indeed the cause of the disease, and he proved likewise that it did not, as had been popularly supposed, inject into the bitten animal a poison elaborated by itself, but that the tsetse acts as the carrier of a living virus, an infinitely small parasite, from one animal to another, which, entering into the bloodstream of the animal bitten or pricked, there propagates and so gives rise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.